My name is Carla Thorson, and I'm Senior Vice President for Programs here at World Affairs. And we're very pleased to have joining us this evening Andrew Weiss, Vice President for Studies at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. As Vice President for Studies at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, Andrew Weiss oversees research in Washington and Moscow on Russia and Eurasia. Prior to this, he was Director of the RAND Corporation's Center for Russia and Eurasia and Executive Director of the RAND Business Leaders Forum. He also served as Director of Russian, Ukrainian, and Eurasian Affairs on the National Security Council staff, as a member of the State Department's Policy Planning Staff, and as a policy assistant in the Office of the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy during the Clinton and Bush administrations. And for those of you who are here tonight, please do see the flyer for his full biography. And please join me in welcoming Andrew Weiss. Thank you. So I think it's fair to say that it's been a busy week, maybe several weeks, or even months. And there's a great deal of increased speculation about the state of U.S.-Russian relations, and we have a lot to talk about. In fact, I'm not sure that there's been as much attention focused on Russia and U.S.-Russian relations since the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991. And you recently authored a report at Carnegie on U.S.-Russia relations and titled it Illusions versus Reality. So I thought we'd just take a tour of some of the realities we see in the relationship today and try to disentangle some of these and think about which ones are mere illusions. So we might as well start with the most immediate news of the day. Our new Secretary of State, Secretary Tillerson, is in Moscow today on the heels of the U.S. administration's decision to retaliate against the Assad regime for using chemical weapons against its own people. We launched 59 Tomahawk missiles and struck an airbase in Syria. Russia, as we know, is a staunch supporter of the Assad regime and has exercised its own military might in the war and insisted that it had brokered an agreement to remove all chemical weapons from Syria. Events this week call that into question, and the U.S. decision to use military force is a significant shift in our own policy in Syria. But is this a fundamental shift in President Trump's insistence that improving relations with Russia is in our interests? Shall we start there?
Sure. No, thank you, Carla, so much for the very kind introduction, and thanks to everyone here who's turned out this evening to talk about these important issues. The situation in Syria is what Samantha Power called in her famous book, The Problem from Hell. And the idea that there is a quick fix in the offing or that we're going to see a return, I think, to some form of really intense U.S. military intervention and potential for deeper commitment, I think at the moment doesn't look likely to me. And so the real challenge for Secretary Tillerson, who's just landed in Moscow earlier today, is what, if anything, can be done diplomatically now that the U.S. has demonstrated that there are certain boundaries of what kind of conduct in this awful, really painful conflict the U.S. is going to assert can't be crossed. So chemical weapons use, the president and his advisors are all saying that's unacceptable. But the other kinds of killing that have led to the deaths of 500,000 or more Syrians and the displacement of millions of people all seems okay, right? Because the United States has had terrible experience in our military interventions in the Middle East, in Iraq, and Afghanistan. So I don't think, and Trump said something tonight, like we're not going into Syria. So the question is, what kind of leverage does that give Rex Tillerson? And I think the problem for him, and this is the same problem that John Kerry had before him, is the or else. And so the United States can't say to the Russians, fix Syria or else, because we're so afraid that the situation either is going to pull us in or even worse, potentially, lead to some kind of inadvertent military conflict between the United States and Russia. And that's getting increasingly hard to manage because our forces are moving closer and closer to each other as we move in on Raqqa.
Mm-hmm. So in your view, is this just a momentary blip intended to sort of punish the Assad regime without upsetting the Russians too much?
I think it looks at the moment, the administration is trying really hard to say this is a special set of circumstances where the U.S. had to do something. But going beyond that, there doesn't seem to be much appetite. There also doesn't seem to be a policy in place that would explain either internally to the U.S. government or externally to our partners around the world and to the people of Syria what we're prepared to do. I think the administration is still figuring that part out, and it's a total hairball of a problem, in part because the Russians intervened militarily in 2015, and they really flipped everything around. What at that point looked like a really dangerous situation for Assad no longer looks that way. The Russians have basically destroyed much of the opposition forces that were facing Assad, and what we've seen as a result is the growth of ISIS, but the forces that the United States and our partners wanted to see replacing Assad, they're now basically, they're on a losing end of this military assault. So for the United States, for us to operate in and around Syria, for us to fly our jets in and around Syria, all that is fraught with incredible risk because the Russians and their partners, the Iranians, have done so much to bolster Assad's standing. So we are sort of operating there in part at Russia's discretion, and if the Russians chose to close airspace to us and make it hard for us to fly, presumably we could do things, but anything we did would entail significant risk of hurting a Russian soldier or Russian personnel on the ground in Syria. And I don't think this administration is really willing to sort of walk down that path without thinking through two or three moves ahead, what the consequences could be, and they could be very, very grave.
So the Russian response to the missile strike seems to, at least in my view, to be relatively muted. I mean, there's definitely a lot of pontificating in the on the news about it, but they haven't really reacted particularly strongly. Is there any reason to believe that President Putin would want to defend Assad's regime use of chemical weapons, or could they be quietly or at least tacitly accepting the U.S. response here?
I read the situation a little differently. I think the Russians are in the tank for Assad. And so if you look at what President Putin said today, where he basically claimed that the U.S. is cooking up sort of fake chemical weapons attacks in the suburbs of Syria, of suburbs of Damascus, and they're going to use that as a pretext for further U.S. military strikes against the Assad regime. If you look at the way the Russians are claiming that, no, Assad has no chemical weapons, this is all part of some elaborate fake news scheme by the Syrian opposition to kind of blame Assad. The Russians are, I think, you know, in a dance with the devil where they basically are stuck with Assad. It's not clear to me that there's an exit for the Russians. They need some kind of diplomatic solution. But everything they're doing in the meantime, I think, is to kind of just grind the war along. It's cheap. It's relatively cost-free for the Russians. There have been very few casualties. And what we're seeing, you know, is, you know, I think for the Russians, in some ways, and we can come back to this more later, something that's a huge gift, which is that the United States is an enemy again. And so whereas they, you know, there were these talk, you know, there's all this talk about how great Donald Trump is and why it's a great sort of kick in the teeth to the U.S. establishment and to U.S. friends around the world to have Donald Trump be the U.S. president, now what the Russians really are focused on is Putin's reelection, which is coming up in March of 2018. And nothing works better in Russian politics than having the United States as this, you know, mythical enemy and to kind of mobilize popular support for the Putin regime on the basis of a besieged fortress where the United States, led by this unpredictable Reagan-like figure, is the, you know, is the perfect, perfectly cast boogeyman for everything that the Russian government portrays in its propaganda as bad for Russia.
So on that note, is there in fact any interest or appetite on the part of Russia to see direct military confrontation with the United States?
Unfortunately, yes. And so one of the main steps that the Russians seem to have taken as a result of the airstrikes late last week is to cut off a channel that was set up between the Russian Defense Ministry and our Pentagon that is supposed to kind of allow people to deconflict operations, particularly in the air, but increasingly on the ground inside Syria. And so just to highlight why this is so sensitive and so important, there have been a series of incidents where U.S. jets flying in and around Syria have come very close to being bumped into by a Russian jet. That probably is a result of Russian sloppiness. It's probably a result of Russian sort of lower technological capabilities in the air. The reason this matters on the ground is we now have increasing numbers of U.S. special forces on the ground doing things to coordinate eventual moves on Raqqa. And about a month and a half ago, there was an incident where the Russians bombed a unit that was working with the United States and killed a bunch of anti-Assad fighters. The U.S. used this hotline channel and told the Russians, knock it off. These are supporters, these are people who we're working with. What's interesting about that incident is our special forces were only about 4 kilometers away when the Russian airstrikes happened. And you can imagine the horrible situation we'd be in today mm-hmm. if an American, God forbid, had been hurt in that kind of attack.
So let's think about Syria in the wider context of the Middle East. And one of the things that the Trump administration has said, and one of the things that he has expressed repeatedly, is the desire to improve relations with Moscow and with President Putin, and in particular because of a sense that Russia could be helpful to the United States in combating terrorism and dealing with ISIS in particular. So why might it be in Russia's interest to have a friendly relationship with the U.S. on terrorism issues in the Middle East?
I'm not sure. I think that's the theory. That's the kind of talking points that Trump used on the campaign, that we're going to knock the hell out of ISIS together, as he repeatedly claimed, or it would be a good thing for the U.S. and Russia to team up. As Bill Clinton said, that dog is not going to hunt. And this is fantasy. It's fantasy for a bunch of reasons. One, the Russians aren't fighting terrorism in Syria. They're fighting Assad's opponents. They've not fought ISIL in any significant way. Two is there's no trust between the U.S. security establishment and their Russian counterparts. And doing things in the counterterrorism realm requires sharing intelligence, sharing how you target groups. We fight terrorism very differently. So the Russians use a kind of more brute force approach where they just, as we saw in the war in Chechnya, they basically, take out entire parts of, city street that has civilians living on it. The United States likes to do things in a more surgical fashion, using a scalpel. The Russians use a sledgehammer. And in light of all the allegations now we have about Russian interference in our domestic affairs, given the scale of Russia's interference in our elections, the very people that you would be relying on to do this kind of cooperation are the most angry. So it's our intelligence service that has uncovered what Russia was doing in our election, and I think they're not going to come within a significant distance of cooperating with Russian counterparts who they believe are an enemy to the United States.
Fascinating. So Syria is a traditional ally of Russia, and it's been one of the sort of stalwarts in the Middle East for Russia. And one of the other countries that has generally been in our camp, if we want to go back to sort of Cold War politics, is Turkey. And the calculus with Turkey is changing in the Middle East right now. And one of the questions that has come up repeatedly is whether or not Turkey is increasingly interested in a more friendly relationship with Russia. Do you want to comment about that?
And sure.
How it might affect the balance?
So part of what's happened, because I think of the U.S. government's reluctance to get more deeply involved in Syria as the Obama administration came to an end, is that Russia and Turkey kissed and made up. And so these two countries, which had this kind of flashpoint military moment of conflict when a Russian jet was shot down by the Turks in the summer of 2015 or 2016, they've now sort of said, we can partner. And part of that required a big change on the Turks' part, where they basically said Assad must go, will no longer be the guiding force between the guiding force behind their policy in Syria. And they've now sort of tried to come up with some kind of arrangement among the Russians, the Iranians, and the Turks to try to figure out what a sort of new governing arrangement will be for Syria, where there will be sort of zones of regional influence split among the three of them. Conspicuously absent from that discussion is the United States. And so up to now, the U.S. in the waning days of the Obama era basically was cut out of some of these efforts, which included an attempt to have a ceasefire. And now what we're looking at is, and if you read what Secretary Tillerson said last night before he went to Moscow, is can we do anything where we sort of coax the diplomacy phase of this back-end operation? I think that's going to be exceedingly hard. Part of it is that the United States and Turkey are at each other's throats. And so there is a really, I think, a deep level of acrimony between the United States and Turkey, but Turkey remains an essential part of our military strategy in Syria because we use bases like the Insular Air Base, which is close to the border between Turkey and Syria, to operate. So we're in this really, I think, really sticky situation where all the things that the Obama administration wants to achieve in the fight against ISIL are heavily dependent on the Turks, but there's no love lost at the moment between the Turkish government and the U.S. government.
Well, so the other country which we should talk about is Iran. The Trump administration has been talking tough, but it hasn't quite gotten, I think, to the question of Iran. And I'm interested in the extent to which this administration is, if we change our position on Iran and we start pressing them, is there any possibility that the U.S. and Russia are going to work together on Iran when it comes to proliferation, or is this another breakpoint?
I think, as with a lot of things about the Trump administration, there's all this kind of big, overheated talk, but no real policies. So we're at a very early stage where very few people have gotten senior jobs. There's a whole process for many of them that involves Senate confirmation, which is even, you know, at the moment, just a glimmer in people's eyes. They just tonight announced the number two person for the State Department, let alone conduct any of the policy reviews that are going to take place. The Russians were basically helpful on the Iran nuclear deal, which is called the JCPOA in terms of its acronym. And they have an important role to play there, and presumably they're happy to have Iran not develop and deploy nuclear weapons, and that would be very destabilizing in their view because it's happening on their doorstep. If, God forbid, there was a, you know, Israeli or U.S. strike against Iran, that would create a whole set of combustible subsequent effects for Russia's interests. The problem is that I think part of it, and come back to sort of the Trump big talk on Russia as a partner in dealing with ISIL, is I think implicit in that whole line of argument, to the extent you can say there's any logic behind it, was the idea that the Russians would team up with the United States to deal with a more meddlesome Iran. And I think, again, this is just fantasy, that the administration had the idea that we could somehow lure Russia away from Iran is, you know, again, just suggests no understanding of why Russia and Iran, for the most part, cooperate, compete in some areas, but the idea that the United States and Russia are ever going to be a perfect tandem that will corner the Iranians who are doing all sorts of devious things around the Middle East, you know, to me, it just smacks of immaturity and mm-hmm. lack of clarity among the core people around President Trump.
So if the intelligence agencies are suspicious and hostile, to what extent can we hope that the diplomatic communications between the U.S. and Russia on these issues are actually going to continue or improve?
Oh, I'm not expecting to see that get much better either. So our relationship with Russia is at a low of low points, and so basic channels of communication aren't working. The number of issues that the U.S. and Russia talk about has been severely circumscribed as a result of Russian aggression in Ukraine in 2014. And then the Russians, and this is the sort of tricky part, keep saying, you know, we'd be happy to talk to you about all these other issues. But in part, they seem to just want to be able to say, see, we've been re-legitimized, things have been normalized, we're, you know, it's as if this terrible thing in Ukraine never happened. And I think the United States and its Western partners are always going to be really careful to strike the right balance. And it's not really clear that if you had more dialogue that it would be productive. So, you know, some of this might just be, you know, a case of the United States chasing after the Russians. And we've had several instances of this in the Clinton era and in the George W. Bush era, and now and more recently in the Obama era, where the United States really wants to talk to the Russians, and that just sort of drives up the price of getting their cooperation. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really important for the new administration not to look like they're panting after or chasing after the Russians.
Mm-hmm. Well, so you've gone in the direction I wanted to go, which is just to talk about Europe and NATO, and specifically about Ukraine. And leaving the U.S. out of it for the moment, what is the end game in Ukraine for Vladimir Putin since the invasion?
Yeah. So his hope is that the United States and our Western partners will simply lose interest, and that we have a sort of grown-up's case of ADD, and that we basically say, Ukraine, hopeless, more important to Russia, and that we just kind of lose interest and we walk away. I think that's a big miscalculation on their part, but it's not totally crazy, because as some folks might have seen earlier today, stories in the press about a comment, a very unfortunate comment that Secretary Tillerson made, where he said something offhandedly like, why would the American taxpayer care about Ukraine? And so, you know, you see comments like that, and you can understand why the Russians feel the way they do, that this just isn't important to the United States. The reason I think it's a terrible miscalculation on their part is that the things that Russia has done in Ukraine are so bad and so egregious in terms of the number of people who have been killed, the complete sort of dismantlement of the basic rules of the road that had prevailed in Europe since the end of World War II, and especially since the end of the Cold War in 1989, that they've created a generations or multi-generations of enemies inside Ukraine. And they've also created hundreds of thousands of people who are going to be prepared to fight and die to protect their independence. So there is no exit for the Russians militarily. They're not able to leave the part of Ukraine where they've fostered this kind of fake insurrection. And they're certainly not going to ever give up Crimea, probably. So we're in this kind of situation where Russia will, I think, remain a terrible violator of basic norms of how the international order works. But at the same time, there's going to be these two armed camps squaring off inside Ukraine. And at any point, this conflict isn't frozen, really. It's slushy, and we could see more fighting and more bloodshed. But there's no real military solution for either of these two sides. Ukraine, I think, will remain armed and ready to defend itself. But on the other hand, Russia is vastly larger, so there's no real easy way for Ukraine to prevail militarily. But at the same time, the Russians, you know, are, I think, would love to create a poison pill in eastern Ukraine where they can create a kind of veto on how the state works and how Ukraine ever will function as a member of the international community. The Ukrainians, are going to just keep resisting that deal.
So is there a political end game here? I mean, one of the speculations is that Russia would like to see Ukraine basically reabsorbed into the Russian state. Is that something that you think is really a motivation, or is it that they simply want to have a puppet regime in Ukraine that's sympathetic to Russia and responsive to Russian interests?
I think this is where the heartbreak begins, is that there will be a permanent conflict or a permanent state of quasi-conflict between Russia and Ukraine. You will have a country which is going through this wrenching domestic transformation that's had 25 years of terrible governance and had, you know, state capture by corrupt elites in Ukraine since 1991. And the work of building a normal, functional, prosperous society is going to take a generation or longer. And the West will remain kind of, you know, just potentially distracted by whatever's on our minds at any given moment. And it's really important for the United States and for key countries like Germany and our partners in the Nordic region to kind of keep everyone focused on why we have to help the Ukrainians and why they've got to perform in exchange for our support. On the Russian side, I think, coming back to this idea of the besieged fortress, second to that, in the minds of many in the Russian elite, is that Russia can only be great if it has a sphere of influence, if it has a neighborhood where Russia basically can tell the rest of the world to buzz off, and that Russia kind of has the veto or the last word on what happens to these countries. That is completely unacceptable, I think, for at least a whole generation or so of U.S. and Western policymakers, the idea that we could have, you know, a Yalta, or we could have secret deals that consign countries in Russia's neighborhood to some sort of lesser status where there are kind of, you know, secret deals that put those countries in Russia's sphere of influence. I think those are terrible concepts that are hopefully banished forever. Unfortunately, we've seen at times during the campaign where Donald Trump says things that sound a lot like that, and we hope that reality and the responsibilities of being in charge of the Western world will, you know, sober up any parts of the Trump administration that might think or act in that respect.
Well, it was certainly one of the catalysts, or one of the things that precipitated the situation in Ukraine was the effort of Ukraine to join the European Union, and that would seem to be a real red line for Russia. And so one of my questions is it sufficient for Russia to prevent any countries it perceives as being in its sphere of influence, what they refer to as the near abroad, from entering the EU or from entering NATO? Is that really?
No, I mean, there's no doubt that the process of expanding NATO and the EU has created this kind of capital case among senior Russian leaders, you know, most obviously Putin, that there's this, you know, effort to contain Russia, and that it's really important for Russia to punch back. I don't think it's ever been seen as truly realistic that Ukraine would ever be in NATO or the EU. And at the moment, that issue has sort of been put aside as not timely. And there have been times, particularly in the George W. Bush administration, where I think there were steps taken or statements that were issued that, you know, created a real sense of fear and kind of needless consternation that might actually happen someday. So I think there have been mistakes made on the U.S. side in that department. What we're seeing now, though, I think, is more that the Russian establishment uses the threat of NATO as a excuse for, you know, everything that they're really scared about. And what they're truly scared about is regime change. And so this is really ultimately at the end of the day about Vladimir Putin's desire to stay in power, for the system to kind of continue in perpetuity that exists today, and a deep fear that there's some Western plot underway that will displace them. And so long as they fear that, and I think they sincerely do fear that, they're going to keep punching back as hard as they can. And so the punching back is attacks on our democracy, it's the buzzing of our planes, it's this kind of, you know, be as unpredictable and dangerous as possible, and basically intimidate the United States and our Western partners in the hope that we won't get too close to the things they really care about.
So let's talk a little bit about NATO. President Trump has made a point of singling out NATO and singling out the NATO alliance and raising questions about our support for that alliance on the one hand, and then on the other hand he says, oh, well, of course we support NATO, or members of the administration say this. And there has been increasing speculation that Russia would like to see the collapse of the NATO alliance, and that this, and one way to do this would be to force a confrontation with one of Russia's neighbors that would lead the NATO alliance to have to choose whether they are going to live up to their responsibilities. So let's look at the Baltic states and talk a little bit about whether you see any evidence to suggest that Putin has plans or designs on the future of Lithuania or Latvia or Estonia. And would that kind of pressure on the NATO alliance have that effect?
So, you know, when we come back, we're always talking about what a great strategist Vladimir Putin is and how, you know, what a great genius he is. I think, as we've seen in the Ukraine case and also in the NATO case, this is a person who's miscalculated horribly. So NATO is a shadow of what it was at the end of the Cold War. The number of U.S. troops in Europe is about 15% of what it was in 1989. But by invading Ukraine and annexing Crimea, Russia has given NATO a new lease on life and has led to a series of U.S. deployments to reassure countries like the Baltic states and Poland and others that the U.S. is serious about defending them, which is one of the solemn commitments we undertook when we admitted them to NATO. So we now have U.S. troops in the Baltic, something that, you know, I frankly never really expected I would see. And we have U.S. troops in places like Poland, which is something that, you know, the Russians in theory should have been striving all these years to avoid. So they've now sort of written into their own defense posture something that will be a challenge for many years to come. The situation in the Baltics is very precarious, and I think there's an assumption which you hear in conventional wisdom conversations, which is like, surely never. The Russians would never do something that reckless because it would trigger NATO's self-defense Article 5 response. Mm-hmm. Up to now, I think we've been wrong about nearly everything that Russia is willing to do and the risks it's willing to run. So, you know, I'm not sitting around thinking tomorrow there will be a military confrontation over the Baltics, but you can come up with any number of really dangerous things that happen where there's an incident in the Baltic Sea. We've all seen, I assume, this video of a Russian jet coming very close to a U.S. Naval vessel, the USS Donald Cook, in the Baltic Sea, where the pilot came within, you know, 10 to 15 feet of our naval vessel. So you can see any number of crises that emerge out of a sort of reckless or kind of not well thought through Russian gambit. And the other thing we're seeing, which I think NATO commanders have to take into account, is that the Russians are using their exercises where they gin up big forces to move around and demonstrate that they're ready and that they're able to do things that basically lead to creating of facts. And so we saw this in the Crimea example most vividly, where something that was dressed up as an exercise ended up actually creating a fact, which was the annexation of a neighbor's territory. So the United States has very few troops. It has a series of European partners that Donald Trump has kind of routinely castigated as not pulling their weight. It's unclear if the United States is really committed to reinvigorating NATO. I hope that this administration is not going to walk away, and I hope that our European partners will not basically find Donald Trump's behavior so unacceptable that they walk away. But we're looking at, you know, basically an entire fabric of what was the Western order, what in sort of wonky terms is called the liberal international order that the United States has been the bulwark of and the main beneficiary of since 1989. And Donald Trump has sort of walked into that saying, that's not really useful to me. NATO's not that useful. The European Union's not that useful. What we need are strong nations, and then we'll cut deals. And I think that's just a fundamentally faulty and misguided view of how the world works. Hopefully, there'll be a sobering up when Donald Trump sees how limited U.S. capabilities are to act without our partners and without these alliance relationships. But how do I say this? He's proven himself to be such a kind of immature and kind of shoot from the hip person. It's really hard to predict what's going to happen.
So can the NATO allies sort of watch our back if we're not paying attention? I mean, there's certainly been reports of Russian troops and movements along the corridor to Kaliningrad. I know that the Obama administration, before the end of the administration, moved to have some advanced military equipment moved into Lithuania so that it would at least be present and stationed in case there was an incident.
So this has been, that was a big initiative at the end of the Obama administration to basically create a tripwire and to deter any possible Russian adventurism aimed at the Baltics or these other Central European countries that feel vulnerable. It is at the discretion of the current U.S. administration whether to keep moving that direction or say we have other priorities and that money or those forces can be better used elsewhere. I hope they don't do that, but none of this is kind of written in stone. We have the European partners and the Canadians who have been also willing to participate in this, but they too have the discretion to basically walk away. I hope that doesn't happen. And then, as we've seen in this region now, in the space of just 3 years since the war in Ukraine started, there can be other scenarios and other things that happen that take everyone by surprise. Just a couple weeks ago, there were a series of demonstrations on the streets of Belarus's capital city and various cities around a country which up to now everyone has thought of as being very authoritarian and very pro-Russian. But what you could imagine is a scenario unfolding there where the people of Belarus say we're mad as hell and kick out the dictator who's ruled that country for 20-plus years, Lukashenko. And at that point, we end up with a replay of what happened in Ukraine, where the Russians say, absolutely not. We can't see this kind of scenario unfolding in another country along our borders and blaming it on the United States and our Western partners. So, the world is really unpredictable. Russia is not the only reason why the world's unpredictable, but they certainly have shown themselves willing to do things that are really reckless and really risky.
So we've been talking about the issues around the world, and one of the questions that I have, I think, is germane to this. How much impact does the Cold War have on the current state of U.S.-Russian relations?
I think that the United States and most people in this room, I think, are looking at the Cold War and the memories of that and kind of trying to lay that over the current dynamic with Russia. And I think that's probably a mistake. The Cold War had this big ideological component where there were these two systems. The Russians had a set of allies around the world and a set of partners, and there was all this competition going on between the two systems. And there were also some rules of the road that kept things from getting totally out of hand, even though we had a couple of dangerous things like along the way, like the Cuban Missile Crisis. The situation right now is so much more unpredictable in many ways, and the rules of the road are basically gone. And the ideological component is also gone. So if you think about what's driving problems around the world, it's not that the U.S. and Russia are squaring off. It's that there's this big rebalancing of power around the world where you have rising powers that want more of a say, whether it's China or India or Brazil and others who want a say about what's going on in the world. You have rivalry between great powers, which is a new dynamic, and constant jockeying among the Europeans, the United States, Russia, other great powers. We have the rise of this awful populist nationalism, including in the United States and in various countries around Europe and elsewhere in the world, where countries are just changing in terms of what they're willing to, how they're willing to structure themselves and what their demanding of their leaders. We have huge technological changes. And so all these factors are playing out simultaneously. And at times, Russia is a source of either opportunism or making some of those problems worse. But they're by no means, like the Soviet Union was, a kind of monolithic sort of, you know, evil force that's driving those major dynamics around the world.
Well, so let's turn to the other elephant in the room, which is the Russian interference in U.S. elections and the accusations of hacking. I think there are a variety of ways we can talk about this, but I think the key question to start with is, to what extent does Russian interference in domestic politics in the United States have lasting repercussions for us?
I think the repercussions are huge. So they're huge in terms of who we are as a people and what we are willing to accept. And I think if there are people in this room who believe it's okay for a foreign government to tip the scales in a competitive U.S. election, I'd really be interested to hear why that's okay. I think all of us would much rather have our presidential race decided by a popular vote. Or through the Electoral College, which is, you know, second best. From my standpoint. Secondarily is we're in a world now where we've seen something that we thought was inviolate, which is the right of the American people to pick our leaders, has now been interfered with due to something really interesting and really innovative that the Russians did, which is it's normal for countries to conduct espionage against each other, to hack in and learn political secrets and sensitive information about each other. But what the Russians did in this case was that they then dumped that into the public. And so that is a big change in terms of how espionage is conducted. And then what's really interesting is the fact that it seems a big portion of the U.S. political spectrum embraced that as kind of a leveler or a force multiplier in a very competitive U.S. political dynamic. So we've got throughout the campaign members of the Trump entourage and Trump himself saying how great it is that WikiLeaks is putting out these embarrassing reports about the Clinton campaign, and doesn't this just show the rot and the corruption inside the U.S. political system? And then on top of that, you had the Russian media apparatus and hackers and others associated with the Russian government trying to amplify that as best they could through social media. So we'll see, and there's sort of three key outcomes here. One is, was this Russian effort going to be repeated elsewhere around the world? Is it going to be repeated in the United States? What can we do to sort of strengthen our defenses to make sure this doesn't happen to us again, doesn't happen to comparable democracies around the world? Two is the law enforcement component of this. Were laws broken? Were U.S. persons involved in breaking the law to support what the Russians were doing? And then third is the national security apparatus the United States needs to suss out. How did the Russians do it? What did Russian intelligence officers do? Did they have helpers inside the United States? And all of those are going to unfold, I think, in a very hothouse political environment, where, as we all know, we're a sharply divided society, where there's a big portion of the United States electorate that thinks this stuff doesn't matter, and then there's a big portion of the United States electorate which thinks this is absolutely crucial, and that it, you know, casts a big shadow over Donald Trump and over his administration.
Mm-hmm. So I don't think that there's too much disagreement that the Russians did this, but I think there is a lot of attention focused in the U.S. on the extent to which there may have been collusion or more. But one of the questions I think you might be better able to think about and answer for us is, what are the Russian interests here in hacking the U.S. domestic election? What outcome are they seeking, and what are they hoping to gain from this kind of activity?
So it's really important to say that this has been part and parcel of previously Soviet and then Russian external behavior going back decades. And so there's a piece I wrote in the Wall Street Journal a month or two ago that tries to explain how the Soviet government in the 70s and 80s used a similar set of techniques to influence developments in countries where the Russians were trying to have either greater sway or do things that would hurt U.S. interests. So this has been a part of the playbook of using propaganda, of using agents of influence, and doing, taking advantage of people's legitimate political activity to sort of push it to a certain direction that would be beneficial to Moscow. So that pattern of behavior is well established. In this particular case, I think there were three parts of it. One is a sense that, well, the United States has been mucking around in Russian politics for the better part of a couple decades. There was great fear in 2011, particularly, and onward, that the United States was trying to foment street demonstrations in Moscow and other major Russian cities. It's, I think, false accusation, but from Putin on down, there's a sincere belief that that's what was happening. So this was all part of a big pushback that began in the sort of early part of 2012 to kind of say to the United States, you can't engineer regime change here as you've done allegedly in places like Egypt or Ukraine. Second was an attempt, I think, to discredit the United States and to basically make us look like we're a corrupt society where, we don't have a real democracy. How dare the United States go around the world promoting democracy? Third was the desire to kind of undermine the presumed Clinton administration if it was going to take power in January and basically create a kind of lasting reputational set of damage to Hillary Clinton and her administration. And then finally was the sense toward the end of the U.S. Presidential campaign that if Russia did all these things, it could actually tip the outcome. And so at some point, the Russian effort went from just, attempting to kind of embarrass us and make us look stupid to something that would actually engineer an outcome that they believed would be more favorable to the Russian government, which is the election of Donald Trump.
And since his election, do we still believe that the Russians think this was the best outcome?
Well, I think they don't like unpredictability. They certainly don't like the fact that, this has become such a firestorm in the United States that it'll be very hard for the Trump administration to do things that might be perceived as a quid pro quo for help from the Russian government during the presidential campaign. But they love the fact that the United States is going through this intense political crisis where we're focused inward, that the government looks like it's kind of going through a huge set of dislocations and disruptions, and that our allies are all kind of running for cover, and that, the U.S. sort of set of relationships around the world are under great pressure, that there's a huge surge of anti-Americanism. All of those things are sort of big wins for the Russian government. And, at the end of the day, we sort of come back full circle. Anything that makes average Russians feel that there's an enemy, an external force that's trying to bring Russia to its knees, and whether it's embodied by an unpredictable Donald Trump or not, is a net win for Putin, who really, is focused primarily on staying in power. He's not focused on trying to create a new modus vivendi with Washington. That's a secondary priority.
So you mentioned this as you were talking about it, and this questioner asks, given Russia's involvement in U.S. elections, how will European countries attempt to address the potential for involvement in their own elections? We have the French elections coming up, for example.
I think European governments are really worried, and so we've seen a pattern of Russian involvement in the Dutch election. There's a report that came out, I believe, in the last couple of days from the Dutch intelligence service that basically explains how fake news and other techniques were used in the recent Dutch parliamentary elections, which have led to the protracted negotiation to set up a new government in the Netherlands. In France, we've seen Russian media operations that were intended to hurt the front runner in that election, which is the young French politician Emmanuel Macron, where there were these allegations that he might be gay, and Russian media have sort of tried to create a whispering campaign that he's in the pay of Jewish bankers. I mean, so like a lot of the same kind of nonsense that went on in our election is now unfolding. And then on top of that, you had this really vivid example of Marine Le Pen, the sort of ultra-nationalist French politician, being welcomed in the Kremlin about 3 weeks ago by Vladimir Putin himself, and he did this very kind of ostentatious media availability where he said, we would never interfere in another country's domestic politics, and there he is sitting with Marine Le Pen, who's received money from the Russians to finance previous campaigns. So all of this is just very much in your face, and where you're left, and this is, I think, just it's sort of shame on all of us, is the Dutch, if I'm not mistaken, it was the Dutch, basically decided they would remove the electronic tabulation procedures for their own election and go back to a manual count. so that they would be relying on systems that would not be so vulnerable to external manipulation. Our election machinery, and this is just, I think, a travesty, is so shot through with potential vulnerabilities that while the U.S. government insists that there was no Russian manipulation of our of the actual tabulation of our election, the reality is that our election machinery is less well regulated than kale. And, you know, like that says something, that kale is more closely regulated than our election machinery. So shame on us.
So you.
And that's not my joke, to be fair. The former head of cyber operations at the Pentagon's joke, not mine. So anyways.
Credit is duly given.
Okay.
So it is clear that Russian foreign policy objectives are designed in part to play to the domestic audience. And so let's turn to Russian domestic politics for a moment. 2 weeks ago, there were protests in Moscow centered on corruption and accusations that the elections to the Russian Duma, the legislature, were rigged. These were the largest protests in Moscow since 2011 and 2012, and seemed to be calling primarily for the removal of Prime Minister Medvedev. But my question to you is, to what extent can we anticipate or hope for challenge to the Putin government in the coming year?
So Vladimir Putin is genuinely popular, and if a free and fair election, I think, were held tomorrow, he would be reelected. And he's popular in part because of this image of standing up to the United States, of conducting this glorious military intervention in Syria, and for the return of Crimea to its rightful owner. And that's the narrative that Russian media broadcast 24/7, and he will, you know, I think, continue to push all of those buttons to keep himself as popular as possible. What we don't know is whether he has to do other things to kind of pump up the volume in the run-up to this election in 2018. What we see among, you know, average Russians is, you know, low information voters who, you know, rely on TV and this kind of toxic propaganda to get their understanding about the outside world, and then a small, small fraction of the urbanized elites and middle class who watch, you know, social media and who have a kind of more kind of, I think, grounded view of reality, who feel, man, this is not working out. The prosperity that Russia experienced, the tremendous gains that experienced under the first, say, decade or so of Putin's leadership has now kind of ground to a halt. There's no social mobility. There's no clear sort of path forward for a lot of younger people entering the workforce. And they're mad. And they go on YouTube and they watch these videos showing incredible extravagance and incredible lifestyle of their prime minister. And then when they hear the call to come out and protest, they're willing to do that. The state presumably is going to push back really hard to punish those people. There are a series of laws on the books in the wake of the 2012 protests that give the state huge amount of leeway to crush people individually or to crush civil society organizations that try to mobilize that kind of opposition. And then this being Russia, which is kind of the land of great political conspiracy going back to the 1917 revolution, there are parts of the Russian establishment that use these protests and use the allegations of corruption to settle scores. So if anyone has gone and looked at the video that triggered these protests, you'll see this incredible drone footage of a country estate that supposedly belongs to the Russian prime minister. It seems implausible that someone could have created that beautiful footage without cooperation from the Russian security services. So it seems in many ways that people are using this as a way to kind of put Putin on notice that, you know, there are other more loyal factions inside the Russian establishment. Surely, Vladimir Vladimirovich, you could rely on us. You know, we would be the real defenders of Russian honor, and you shouldn't be relying on Dmitry Medvedev. So there's a lot of levels at which this is all going to unfold.
Well, so in terms of Russian popular opinion, there's a great deal of manipulation and a great deal of propaganda. It's not that they don't have access to other sources of information. It's increasingly that they choose to consume the information that they find most sympathetic. So how do Russians view the United States? Do they buy into the Putin message that we are the mythological enemy?
I think overwhelmingly people do. And so, you know, if, you know, let's say Vladimir Putin got hit by a bus tomorrow, we would still be dealing with a Russian body politic that is inherently susceptible to view the United States as a hostile force, and a Russian political elite, which is going to, if anything, be more aggressive and more inclined toward a kind of competitive relationship or confrontational relationship with the United States. And then if you take it forward a generation or so, you've got people who have lived now through a very tumultuous period where sanctions were imposed on Russia, who've led covert military activity in places like Eastern Ukraine, and all of those people, as they come up in the system, I think are going to be, if anything, more emboldened and see that, you know, a strategy of using asymmetrical tools to kind of deal with an overbearing, far more powerful the United States, all of those people, as they come up in the system in the generation that succeeds Putin, those people, I think, are going to be potentially more difficult for the United States to deal with.
All very optimistic. You
absolutely.
Are. Absolutely. So one of the questions from the audience is, what, if anything, would you advise U.S. policymakers to do, either overtly or covertly, to support domestic opposition to the Putin regime?
So I think this was, you know, it comes back to the title of this longer paper and the task force that we convened, where we had sort of senior Republican and Democratic national security practitioners getting together and thinking about managing the U.S.-Russian relationship through this next phase. Is one of the things I think we do need to really sort of be more restrained about is the idea that people from outside can choose things for Russia or engineer outcomes inside Russia. I think that was one of the big misunderstandings in the early 90s, where people's expectations about how quickly Russia was going to change or the kind of political system Russia was going to develop were, I think, way out of keeping with either historical patterns or what the Russian people themselves were seeking. Now, I think what we're dealing with is, you know, in terms of what I think is really first order priority for U.S. policymakers, is what, if people may remember this metaphor that Tim Geithner used in the 2008 financial crisis, is to put as much foam on the runway as possible to avoid a possible military event that either leads to a crisis or some sort of unintentional escalation. And to me, the opening of channels of communication, particularly between our militaries, is really the biggest priority. As we've seen in Syria, as we've seen in and around NATO's border with Russia, there's just too many elements of risk that have been dispersed, and a lot of deliberate Russian efforts to act in ways that look crazy to push us to back off.
So the other thing that happened recently in Russia is this bombing of the metro in St. Petersburg, and it raises questions about the rise of domestic terrorism in Russia. Do you have any sense of what the source of this blast was and how it relates to Russian foreign and domestic policy?
So there have been a series of subway attacks, I think in 2011 and 2014, maybe 2009, 2011, and then there was a bombing in Volgograd in the run-up to the Sochi game. So these kinds of incidents have happened. There is a large population of migrant workers from Central Asia who are working as construction workers or doing menial jobs in and around Russia. And while no one has been able to pinpoint exactly who this person, this potential suicide bomber, was in St. Petersburg, the pattern that we've seen is that people come, they're stripped of their sort of normal kinship and other sort of support network. They live in these terrible conditions. There's horrible racism and other attacks on guest workers, and they get radicalized. And then some of them are going on to fight in Syria. So the pattern seems to be of people who are fighting, who are from the former Soviet Union, who are fighting with the jihadists in Syria. They seem to have been radicalized primarily inside Russia. So that's the kind of going theory of what happened here. Mm-hmm. And there's clear fear inside the Russian government that we're seeing pockets of radicalization in and around various parts of the Russian Federation. And so the part of what was motivating Russia's military intervention in 2015 was the idea that it would be better to go after those people in Syria than have them come home. I'm skeptical that the Russians can do that effectively and that they won't face more of these kinds of attacks going forward. But up to now, the pressure that the Russian security services are willing to inflict on average people, the willingness to kind of racially profile and go after huge swaths of their population, is very different than what we would accept in the United States or in Western Europe.
Well, so some of the conspiracy theorists have looked at these attacks that have happened in Russia and have specifically suggested that Putin has used the apartment bombings that happened in Moscow and that this could be another opportunity for Putin to use the specter of domestic terrorism as a way of building his own support.
There's
Do you subscribe to that at
all? Yeah, no, there's no doubt that the regime immediately both sort of jumped on the attack as a way to kind of mobilize popular support for Putin himself. And so they staged rallies. They put a big concert on in front of the Kremlin late last week. So it's, you know, there is a smack of opportunism. I mean, it all smacks of opportunism and kind of shameless, you know, sense that we're under threat and that, you know, this is why we're fighting in Syria. This is, you know, the hand of, you know, our enemies. So there's a lot of that going on. We, you know, I think as with most things about Russia, the country is so impenetrable, it's almost impossible to ever really know what's happened. And then there are these layers upon layers of conspiracy theory that accompany that. You know, I believe, you know, I'm more of a non-conspiracy minded person myself, and so I tend to look at these bigger drivers of change that I was just describing, which is, you know, enormous numbers of people displaced, living in Russia, cut off from their normal support mechanisms, and then the penetration by radical groups of religious institutions inside Russia that help sort of radicalize people and lead to these kinds of tragedies.
Mm-hmm. Fair enough. So one of the things we haven't talked about is the Russian economy. And so this questioner asks, given the state of energy prices, can the Russian economy sustain Putin's more aggressive foreign policy positions?
So part of what's interesting about the Russian foreign policy that we're watching is that the government constantly seems to be willing, when faced with choices between guns and butter, to pick guns and doesn't care about the impact that that may have on living standards or the fact that the average person is feeling a loss of the sort of rapid gains in socioeconomic terms that they experienced since 2000 when Putin came to power. So the price of oil is the key driver of Russia's prosperity, and the government benefits a great deal when price of oil goes up, and the average oil company or the average consumer really benefits only in a kind of knock-on effect. To my mind, the Russian government's ability to keep this party going and to kind of sustain things almost indefinitely with oil prices where they are in the $40 to $50 range is pretty straightforward. They can play whack-a-mole and sequester or not pay people and just basically keep things going indefinitely. If oil prices are $10, it's a whole different story, and that's when some really hard changes, hard choices would materialize. But you know, for now, the name of the game is stability. It's not reform. So in the period of the next 11 months before the elections, there's talk about big economic blueprints and changes afoot. But the instinct of the government is going to be to crack down on possible sources of opposition and to kind of tell everyone, you know, especially at the commanding heights of the economy, you need to keep people happy, keep people off the streets, and sort of just basically live to fight another day.
So in terms of the relationship between the two leaders, between Trump and Putin, this questioner asks, to what extent are the recent public disagreements designed to silence critics who claim that they're too close or wanting to be too close?
I think that there have been a couple of statements, including I think I saw one today from one of Donald Trump's kids saying, yeah, you see, there's no Russian hand in the election, or no, you know, there's no love lost between the Trump people and the Russian government. You know, this comes against just an enormous number of statements that Trump himself has made that to my mind are inexplicable, including the one on the Super Bowl interview with Fox News, where he, you know, created equivalence between the conduct of U.S. military personnel in Iraq and Russian attacks on opponents of the Putin regime. So, I mean, I can't get my head around, like, why someone would talk so constantly and such puffery about Vladimir Putin. It's something about it that just doesn't either connect to my values or to what I think our country's values are. So I can't explain it. But I think that for, you know, the Russians, the real question is, can they sort of sucker Donald Trump into doing things? Can he, you know, can Vladimir Putin, who's dealt with so many world leaders over the past 17 years, run circles around an inexperienced American president who's really new to most of these foreign policy issues, whose views on a lot of things and whose instincts on a lot of things seems to be 180 degrees away from where they should be? So in many ways, the fact that there's so much scrutiny now and that there's so much pressure on the Trump administration to show, see, we're not in Russia's pocket, I think that will sort of box in the administration. But at the same time, Donald Trump repeatedly seems to say the rules of normal political gravity don't apply to me, and, you know, says things or does things that are just completely not in normal keeping with previous presidential behavior. So, you know, I think the more scrutiny, the better. But it's really early days, and what they're going to find is that, you know, they've got to now manage all sorts of complicated foreign policy challenges, whether it's the crisis in North Korea, possible situation getting out of hand in Syria, that in some ways the world's just going to come at them fast and furious. And so whatever, you know, sort of kooky ideas Donald Trump came to the presidency with, he'll probably be disabused of, just because the world is so much more challenging and the responsibilities of being president are so immense.
So I think the last question I will ask is a question from the audience, and I'll supplement it. Please discuss the worst-case scenario for Russia and the United States. And no. I would just add, I want to come back to the premise of this whole conversation, which is the relationship with the United States and Russia too broken to fix?
Yeah. No, I think it is too broken to fix. And so I think what we really are looking at is a question of sort of risk management and trying to just kind of keep things from ever tipping over into some form of direct confrontation. And I think that's what job one is just basically keep things from getting worse. At the same time, I think, you know, we are living through something that's just unprecedented. We've now had a foreign government, interfere in our elections. I think had a decisive impact on how our presidential campaign unfolded in 2016, and we're now seeing a Russian government which views risk-taking and doing things that sort of are completely beyond the bounds of post-1989 behavior as their sort of stock and trade. And, you know, the idea that we know where this is going to go or how this is all going to unfold or that it's all going to be okay, I think we need to work really carefully to avoid things that we all fear from happening, and sort of work really hard to sort of bolster the alliances that have kept our country safe, to keep our friends, like the Germans, for example, close to us, and to work as closely as possible with them instead of pushing them away. There's a reason, there's a great line that General Mattis had when he was up for his confirmation hearing, where he basically said something to the effect of, if we have no friends, we don't get anything done. And I think part of what's so disturbing about the pattern of Donald Trump's behavior is he doesn't seem to really understand just how fragile a lot of those friendships are, and why people look to the United States to provide certain benefits to the world, and in exchange are willing to cooperate with us. That's not just something that people do to be nice.
So thank you very much, Andrew. And before we open up the floor for discussion with all of you in the room, I'd like to say goodnight to our radio listeners. And please join me in thanking Andrew Weiss for this excellent discussion on this critical issue.